Here are the most interesting facts you did not know about flying. Number 12, a hole in the window. Window or aisle, everyone has one of those as a seat they want for a long flight. If you're a window person, you've probably wondered about that little hole that's on the window. Like many things on the plane, the size and position of that tiny circle has been carefully calculated for a specific function. Airplane windows are composed of three panes of acrylic. The outer pane is fully solid, and as you probably figured out, is responsible for maintaining cabin pressure. The pane with the hole is in the middle, and it's there to protect passengers in case the outer pane breaks, even with the small hole, technically called the bleed hole. The bleed hole actually reduces the pressure on the middle pane, so only the outer pane takes the force of the cabin pressure. While both the outer and middle panes have the power to resist the pressure from outside the plane, the brunt of the work falls on the outer window as it's the final barrier. Number 11, lightning all the time. The mere thought of flying is already scary enough for a lot of people. How about let's add flying during a thunderstorm? Flying through a storm is probably one of the most stress-inducing events that a passenger can endure, as there's plenty of turbulence and lightning. However, lightning actually poses very little danger to an airplane. In fact, the FAA estimates that every plane currently in service in the United States gets hit by a lightning bolt at least once a year. An airplane's outer skin does a great job of letting the electrical charge pass through and onto the ground without damaging anything on the inside of the plane. The only residue are tiny burn marks from the entry and exit points. High winds and booms from thunder are actually more threatening. So, next time your plane actually gets hit by lightning, you can relax. It's just much scarier than it actually is. Number 10, climate and bumpiness? There are plenty of people out there that are convinced global warming is happening. There are also plenty of people out there who think otherwise. Adding to the debate are studies that show climate change might make the flying experience worse. Changes to the jet stream could make flights longer and more turbulent. Higher temperatures could affect the maximum takeoff weight, meaning more weight restrictions and flight cancellations. Increased carbon monoxide in the atmosphere is apparently rerouting jet streams, which, in case you didn't know, are high-altitude wind currents created by the temperature differential between the North and South poles and the tropics. That differential is increasing, making currents stronger and causing a measurable difference in what's called clear air turbulence. This effect doesn't cancel itself out, and in fact, on the transatlantic route, the cost could amount to $22 million in additional fuel costs every year. Number 9. Ask for cash. Airlines love to overbook. Statistically, every flight is going to have at least one or two no-shows, and of course, by selling tickets in excess of what the plane can hold, they ensure they make the maximum they can. And they're usually right, because I mean, what's the point of hiring MBAs without maximizing profits? However, as when everybody shows up, unfortunately for the airline, bumping happens. If you're bumped to a later flight because of overbooking, airlines will typically offer you travel vouchers for your inconvenience. But guess what? You can demand cash instead. The Department of Transportation mandates payments of up to $1,300 depending on how long you're delayed. As long as it's over an hour, you're entitled to some money. This, however, has been a very well-kept secret because by offering you another seat, the airline is not actually losing money, whereas if you actually get paid, they do. Number 8. Turbulence is just turbulence. The words airplane, turbulence, and fear have a habit of popping up in the same sentence. But it turns out that airplane turbulence isn't something you need to worry about. Why? Because turbulence doesn't represent a threat to your plane. In fact, there are no examples in recent decades of an airplane crashing because of turbulence. Conditions might be annoying and uncomfortable, but the chances of the plane crashing is extremely low. Turbulence is an aggravating nuisance for everybody, including the crew, but it's also, for lack of a better term, normal. From a pilot's perspective, it's ordinarily seen as a convenience issue, not a safety issue. When a flight changes altitude in search of smoother conditions, this is by and large in the interest of comfort. The pilots aren't worried about the wings falling off, they're trying to keep everyone relaxed and everybody's coffee where it belongs. Number 7. Oxygen masks. The safety instructions on most flights include how to use the oxygen masks that are deployed when the plane experiences a sudden loss in cabin pressure. However, one thing that the flight attendants don't tell you is that oxygen masks only have about 15 minutes worth of oxygen. That sounds like a really short amount of time, but in reality, it's more than enough oxygen. We have to remember, oxygen masks drop when the airplane cabin loses pressure, which also means the plane is also losing altitude. A pilot will respond to that situation by moving the plane to an altitude below 10,000 feet, where passengers can simply breathe normally, no extra oxygen required. That rapid descent usually takes way less than 15 minutes, meaning those oxygen masks have more than enough air to protect passengers. Number 6. Airplane rooms. During a 14-hour flight from New York City to Tokyo, passengers will likely eat several meals, watch some questionable movies, and get in a few hours of sleep. But for the flight attendants and pilots who are on duty, 14 hours translates into a very long workday. That's why some airplanes are designed for long-haul flights, such as the Boeing 777 and 787 Dreamliners, which are outfitted with tiny bedrooms where the flight crew can catch a little shut-eye between serving meals and dueling out tiny bottles of wine. If you're not an airline staffer, you'll likely never see the little sleeping compartments tucked away just above the main cabin. In flight amenities for flight attendants depend on the particular plane, just as they do for paying passengers. The Boeing 777 even has a separate area for pilots with two beds, two business class seats, and in some airlines, a bathroom area with a sink or lavatory. Don't worry, both pilots aren't sleeping at the same time, and the flight attendants are still at work and remain on call in case of emergencies. Well, theoretically anyways. Number 5. Lights on dim. When an airplane cabin's lights dim, well-traveled passengers instinctively know their flight has been cleared for takeoff, or that they're in the final moments of descent before the plane touches down. And although the lowering of cabin lights is widely accepted as a safety procedure, what purpose does it actually serve? Well, they actually dim the lights so that your eyes can get acclimated. During nighttime takeoffs and landings, you dim the lights so that you have some night vision going on. Dimming cabin lights during the day, then, is less necessary, but it does conserve some engine power as the plane gets ready to take off. Airplane power aside, it can take our eyes between 10 and 30 minutes to fully adjust to a dark setting. The primary reason for a change in cabin lights is directly connected to also why crew members ask passengers to raise their shades during landings, which is safety in case of an emergency. Number 4. Window shades open. Have you ever wondered why airplane passengers are always asked by cabin crew to raise their blinds along with other things such as having seats in the upright position and seat belts buckled at the start and end of every flight? Maybe you guys have figured out that these practices are for the safety of passengers. Takeoffs and landings are considered to be critical times in aviation, as many complications can occur during this time. These instructions are a part of a long process to prepare the cabin for sudden emergencies. In the case of an emergency, the cabin crew has only 90 seconds to evacuate all passengers regardless of the size of the aircraft or the number of passengers. Open shades help the crew to see outside conditions to help them in planning the evacuation. Open shades also allow passengers to help point out anything that's going on outside. Number 3. Only one engine. The idea of an engine giving out mid-flight sound like it'd be a catastrophe, but every commercial airplane can safely fly with just one engine. What would really be one is if both the engines failed. Operating with half the engine power can make a plane less fuel efficient and may reduce its range, but planes are designed and tested for such situations. Any plane scheduled on a long-distance route, especially those that fly over oceans or through uninhabited areas such as the Arctic, must be certified by the Federal Aviation Administration for extended range twin operations, which is basically how long a plane can fly with one engine. For example, the Boeing Dreamliner can fly for 5.5 hours with just one engine. In fact, most airplanes can fly for a surprisingly long distance with no engine at all. Although this isn't exactly a situation you want to be in. A Boeing 747 can glide for 2 miles for every 1,000 feet that they are above the ground, which is usually more than enough time to get everyone safely to the ground. Number 2. Morning flights versus evening flights. How many times have you boarded a flight and maybe noticed one or two passengers who seem like they're super nervous? You might pass it off as general stress or dissatisfaction with the airline, but they could actually be suffering from fear of flying. Wide eyes, clenched fists, profuse sweating, and rocking motions are among the telltale signs of someone who's freaked out by flying. Apparently, if you're nervous about flying, booking a morning flight is your best bet because that's the time with the least turbulence. Most thunderstorms are reported in the afternoon and generally clear overnight, meaning there's less windy weather to contend with. Cooler temperatures also help, as hot air rising from the ground can make a flight bumpier. The later your flight is, the hotter the ground becomes and the more turbulence. Number 1. The smoothest part of the plane. The general flow of air on any airplane is from front to back. So if you're really concerned about breathing the freshest possible air, or not getting too hot, sit as close to the front as you can. Planes are generally warmest at the back. If safety is your main concern, then bad news for you, there is no safest place to sit. Both people sitting in the back and in the front have died in plane crashes. But if the bumpy ride is what keeps you up at night before your flight, then relax, there is a portion of the plane where it is smoothest. Airplane turbulence can make for a bumpy ride, but seats over the wing and in front of it will get less of the unsettling wobbliness. Like a playground seesaw, the center of the plane moves less than the ends. At the wing, the slight rotation isn't that noticeable, but at the tail, the up and down motion is. So if you're nervous about flying or just hate turbulence in general, sit towards the middle of the plane. Here's what's next.
Not anyway. Consisting of three artifacts, the Baghdad Battery, or the Parthian Battery, as some people call it, has puzzled scholars, scientists.